Here we go. I picked up, for only a dollar, not whatever Amazon price they have, the most common and also most hated, in my opinion, DSiLL, 3DS and 3DS LL, thought they were XL, whatever, chargers. These claim to work, but also claim to not work. Now, I have it for one reason that'll be shown in a later video. But I want to do a teardown of this. I don't trust on my DS. It feels very bad and just a little too light. I mean, mind you, the Game Boy Advance ones were pretty light, and I should compare to it, but there's a lot of space in here. They could actually have a full transformer, and this is a nice supply, but somehow I doubt it. I bet it's just a look standard. And in here is the tiniest circuit board with a transistor, a resistor, a capacitor, maybe a little tiny coil, and not much else. Spindly little wires. That's a pretty... Some people have problems with this internal mechanism for handling this turning braking. So that might be what lets this power supply down. No, it looks pretty good. They even have some foam on top for the transformer. It's kind of nice. Let's kind of step through it here. One of the inputs goes right through this resistor that I assume they're using as a fuse. That then goes to this part of the bridge rectifier. This side goes through these two diodes of the bridge rectifier, and you've got your positive and negative here with a fully rated 400 volt 6.8 mic capacitor. It's the brand is some circles, claims to be 105 degrees Celsius cap, so that's nothing bad there. Goes through some minor circuitry, nice little surface mount stuff done as flow soldered. It's glue dots for the surface mount components and then wave or flow soldered. You get the idea. Nice, I mean they're precariously in here, but nice enough transistors or whatever these packages might be. Opto isolator for feedback, little diode. I don't see any type of like noise suppressing capacitors. And the MOVs and whatever else. So that's slightly disappointing. Tiny capacitor there on this part. It might be alright, but based on reviews, I don't want to trust it. We're just kind of testing wear on this. It holds on there pretty well. I think probably the joint breaks most commonly here. Yeah, that looks like the weakest link in this. Yeah, there we go. So that's probably the weakest link of the whole thing. Sure, I know, I was stressing it, but how many times are you going to charge your DS in a week? Once or two times, it took about 15, break it in a month probably. Longer than a 30-day return. Bit of crust on the diodes, I don't know. I wouldn't call this terrible, it probably works, but I could see where a lot of people have trouble. But what I'm interested in. Subscribe and stay tuned for the next video to show you what this power supply is really useful for. Alright, just so we can do some electrical testing on this unit, I've attached just some wires to the output, reattached the connector with some new wire, just generic-y stuff, poorly done. And then what I'm going to go ahead and do is make this to where this piece doesn't rotate or doesn't rotate easily, so you don't have to worry about twisting in and out for stress. I think I did the wires the wrong way. I think you were supposed to go out and around or whatever, but that's alright. We're going to fill this part in with super glue, and then a little bit later we'll fill in this block once we put the backing on, so that should prevent you from being able to shut it or shut it easily. And then we'll do some kind of electrical testing on it and see what it looks like. Oh, and to make life easy, these clamps are great. So this holds this as deep as it'll go in there. Then we can just fill this in with some hot glue. Look, I already got some on the case. All right, we'll put the backing on. Ah, we should have done this while it's hot. This has to actually latch in around the plug like a smart design. So Oops. I'm not too concerned. We'll just screw this in and... In reality, if you're worried about the wire snapping in your own model, go ahead and just apply the glue here, and that should be actually good enough. Let's do some electrical testing on this. So we've got the scope probe hooked to directly to the output of the power supply. We've got our current meter for when we start actually using a dummy load. And then over on the oscilloscope here. So here we've got AC coupling and DC coupling. So that'll be, yellow will be our AC, any type of ripple, and DC will be our actual DC offset. Random settings for the moment we'll adjust as we actually probe. But for the moment, we'll plug this in. The current meter's off because we're not going through our load yet. Turn on the supply. All right. So we can already see it doing some weird stuff there. No reason to think it's bad. There's no load right now. It is 5.4 volts on the output. There's about 200 millivolts of ripple. And this is switching at about 350 hertz. So let's go ahead and attach. Make sure I don't get this wrong here. Right through there, so the... Okay, so this is a 500 milliamp load, about. And we can see quite a bit of ripple, 500 millivolts of ripple. Our voltage is still around 5.6, 5 volts per division. We can see it's slightly above 5 volts. Let's go ahead and look in this ripple a bit more. Oh, and we're drawing, like I said, it's 500 milliamp load or so, and it's drawing about 450 milliamps, so not bad. So the switching frequency is about 56 kilohertz around there. This is actually a little bit accurate. Sometimes it's about 67 kilohertz. Let's see if we can trigger a bit better. Let's just trigger on these high peaks here. Yeah, so... And, oops. Quite a bit of bounce. Let's look over time. All right, let's switch this up to the full amp, see what this thing can actually do. So it can actually put out about 750 milliamps about. That's really losing stability. Yeah, that's, we're actually putting ripple on the DC line. Yeah, if we zoom out, we can actually see there's quite a bit of ripple on this now. So it won't do an amp, but it doesn't look too terrible on the... We'll go back to the 500. It doesn't look too terrible on the 500 milliamp. It would probably charge. And again, that switching noise is not that much. I mean, this looks like it's actually holding up. So this power supply is not too bad of a supply. And let's just compare to a USB power supply. Here's this Google power supply I have sitting around. It claims 5.1 volts at 850 milliamps. I have no idea what it's from. Standard USB cable. I put it in the wrong way, but that's fine. We're drawing about 400 milliamps. So the ripple on it. So, as we can see, it's about 48 millivolts ripple. You can see almost nothing on the DC line. It's putting out 4.4 volts. And this is, yeah, it's definitely set to the 500 milliamp setting. So this is actually, even at half its rating, it's a bit lower than 5 volts and 5.1 volts is actually apparently reading at, but if we put this to the 1 amp, it'll actually draw 650 milliamps. We can see quite a bit more ripple. Oh, the switching noise, we have to actually increase this a bit. It's around 60 kilohertz again. The ripple is still only about 50 millivolts. This is actually doing really well. We did see the voltage drop, so this can't really handle the load as much. It pulls the voltage down a lot faster. That's fine. Oh, I'll just show this bit. It actually has the polarity on the adapter. That's actually really nice. And for anyone wondering, they couldn't quite tell, my dummy load is just 2.5 volt miniature base lamps or Christmas lights. Since they're 2.5 volts, we've got two of them in series, and then they're all basically in parallel, but it's switchable between the first bank and then both banks. So we've got five sets here for about 500 milliamps, depending upon your voltage, and then you put them both in. It should be about an amp. We should get a supply that can pump out an amp and see if this actually does it, but that would be for a different video, I'm sure. It's better than me trying to find a high power resistor for doing dummy loads. This just, it draws current. And since we're not concerned too much about the overall current, because obviously these are going to change with heat and everything, we've got the current here. It's not like we need a constant current source or anything. We know what we're drawing. We just want to see how the power supply reacts. Now this is a real, genuine Nintendo one, and the quality is just staggeringly different. So first off, if you're trying to open one of these, they've got those little security bit screws with the little nub in the center. Luckily, it's not the standard Nintendo one that my extension bit trick almost works with, because it doesn't quite work in the Game Boy case. But luckily, the DS seems to have the security bit ones with the nub in the center. A Torx 7 will just about do it. I'll take a macro shot, but I had to get a little crazy with this screw. The nub kind of shifted when I was playing with a flathead to try to get this working better. And basically, I was just using the tiniest bit of grip, a lot of downward pressure, and I could lift it out and then use pliers to get it out. So, needless to say, I'll be putting back different screws that don't suck. Let's get to this real power supply. First off, they glued components down. There, this transformer has some sort of like Captain Tape style stuff all around it. Very nice stand-up inductors. These are genuine Rubicon caps. You know, highest quality you can get pretty much. Looks like this is their fusible resistor. And then the back, this is where the insanity and magic is. So first off, the clip style. They use nice little wire clips instead of crappy wires. So these sit in here, and when you retract this blade over, it no longer makes any electrical contact to these clips. But once you spring this up, you've got contact on these little clips here. Really great. They have this isolation slot cut into, or extended out into the actual molding, and then they put some sort of rubbery material, maybe silicone, maybe not. But so that molds it and gives you absolutely perfect isolation, or, you know, as good as you could get in this size. Because normally this distance, while acceptable for generic-y off-brand power supplies, this is not really that well rated. So they stuck this stuff here, and you can't, gross overloading, sure, you could have some sanity going. But the bottom is just densely populated. It looks like an opto-isolator for feedback. They've emitted something here with glue dot. So it's glue dot with flow soldering, wave soldering, whatever you want to say. That's the bridge rectifier. This is your opto isolator. So it looks like this is all primary, and this is your secondary side. We can verify that. 350 volt cap here, 350 volt cap here. So this is on your primary. Out the secondary side has a 10 volt. Looks like Zebra OEM'd this for Nintendo, but hey, if you're going to get this quality of a device out of it. Looks like this is interesting. Looks like they stuck the switching component, bound that over, and then the other one's just flush mounted to the PCB, and they're kind of stuck together with the glue. So nothing can really move in this. I mean, maybe if they wanted to be more fun, they could stick just a tiny bit somewhere around here, but, you know, they really have to worry that much. So yeah, this is a proper supply. It looks nice. Again, this is for DS Lite and not DSi or 3DS or anything like that, but still stands to show you that this will get the job done. But I recommend, it'll work in a desperate pinch. I recommend not using it as far as safety and all that other stuff. you're better off with a real or very good off-brand, but this is probably this will just do in an emergency, but again, I like the idea of harvesting it for a connector and using a very good USB supply. See ya, space engineers.